Hallelujah. One day we'll be here for our couples program so that we can speak to you about how to have paradise in your house. We've enjoyed every bit of it for 24 years and we are still enjoying it. Marriage is not for endurance, it's for enjoying it. The Lord will bless you. When I came to live with Pastor Roland and his wife, I saw love in the house. The mama refused to grow. How do you know a woman that is well taken care of? They don't grow it. Even 50 years after marriage, you still see mama putting on the powder and a very small something. You see, sharp, sharp, sharp woman. No, something is happening. That the more anointing, sir. Somebody say, more anointing, sir. Hallelujah. I ask the young ones to pray that you won't miss it. Marriage could be heaven or hell. The choice is yours. Marriage could be heaven and it can be hell. It's your choice. I've made mine. It's my choice. But I pray for all the young ones in this church. You will not miss the bone of your bone.
Amen.
Let God arise. Psalm 102 verse 13. God send me to three people here today. Only three. So if you are not one of them, please, I pardon you and I want to ask for apology that God didn't send me to you. But only three people he sent me to as the women gathered to celebrate their day. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion. For the time to favor her, yea, the said time is come. So the time to favor Zion has come.
Amen.
You see, she said her, not him, not he. So he's talking to women. That's why they are the only one giving answer, responding to that prayer. Amen. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion. For the time to favor her, yea, the set time is come. Look at verse 16 and see what God is about to do for Zion. In verse 16 of that place, when the Lord shall build up Zion, it shall appear in his glory. When the Lord shall build up Zion, when the Lord will build the woman fellowship here, when the Lord will finish building the men in the church here, they shall appear in their glory.
Amen.
You know, I told you on Friday that glory cannot be separated from God. God and glory is one. And do you know God sent me to only three people? Three Zions, the Zionians that are suffering, to set them free. Psalm 126 from verses 1 to 6. I want the whole church to come together. Let's read it. And I will share with you those three kind of people that God sent us to. And when, if they are here, we pray for them. We anoint them and we release them. And I tell them, when testimony ceases in the church, it's an indication that I have to resign my appointment. I have to go and look for another job. It's better to be a bus conductor than to be a man of God and there is no testimony in the church. It's better. Testimony of men validates our calling. If it sees, it's a sign that you are gone. God has ended with you. Are you with us? Am I talking to somebody here?
Yes, sir.
When there is no more, that's what we find there. We can see all of us radiating in glory. That's his testimony. It shows that testimony is operating here. If there is no more, when we call men, what do you have to say? What has God done for you? And there's nothing. That is an indication that God has done away with that man of God. Then we need to look for another servant of the Most High. And the men on the altar here ministry for the past 24 years on full time. The only thing that helped me is the testimony of men. Yours will be added. If you are the one, your amen should single you out.
Yes.
Let's read together from verses 1 to 6. Are we ready? One to go. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter, and our tongue with singing. Then said they among the heaven, the Lord hath done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. Whereof we are glad. Turn again our captivity, O Lord, as the stream in the sand. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weeping, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing a sheep with him. So shall it be in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Who are the first set of people the Lord sent me to? They are found in verse 1 of that Psalm 126. And you see, when the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. These are the first set the Lord sent me to. They are the captives. They are Zion, but they are suffering. Their captivity is strong. They are under a terrible bondage. There is a power over their destiny that held them captive. They are under the influence of an authority that is stronger than them. Everyone that meets them say, "How are you?" They say, "It's fine," but deep down, it's not fine. Who are they? They are men that work hard, but no result, nothing to show for. They toiled all night like Peter. They caught nothing. Did you know what he said? I toiled all night. You know the meaning of toiling? They work hard all night, but what is this? What do you show for it? Nothing. They are under the terrible conditions. The devil and his agent are monitoring their destiny. And that is, they are under a great captivity. And God is saying to me, I will turn it around.
Amen.
That is it. He does it for Zion. And he's going to do it for you.
Amen.
Who are they? They are people that go to bed, but they are full of evil dreams. They continue to have terrible nightmares. They brought a guy to us for prayer. Because anytime I go to bed, one unseen hand will slap me. And I will receive 3 dirty slaps every night. Go! He will open the door. Yeah! Yeah! Anytime you see the dark of the day, fear will creep him. I was sharing that testimony in the church where I went for deliverance. And the pastor of that church, there's a woman in this church who came here. They slapped her also 3 times in a day. But when they slap her, she will get hungry. And she has to go and cook and prepare for a bath and not pour. And she has to cook like that 3 times in the night. There are some people, they wake up in the morning. What they witness in the night is enough to handle for 1 year. Loads upon them. What do you talk about, unseen man? Spirit husband having free sex with you in the night. How can you see a woman giving birth in your dream? Have you seen a man who you see yourself in America still wearing your old uniform you wore in the village 40 years ago? And you wake up, whatever that brings you up and makes you terrified, you are so down and you can't explain, is the hand of your enemy against your life. That is captivity. Sometimes you wake up and you see yourself in a pool of blood. Did you know that man was sharing a testimony with us? He said in his dream, he saw himself eating meat. And when he woke up, he found meat in his mouth. Physically. In the dream, he saw himself, they gave him a meat and he was eating it. When he woke up, meat came out of his mouth. Do you know, sir, there are some people in U.S., they go to bed in the night and they still see the masquerade from their father's house, and the masquerade is still pursuing them here. Some snakes. Some in their dream, they see themselves in a coffin, ready for burial. I know somebody is here that God sent me. I prayed and I saw the face of God. God said his tummy in with the captivity of Zion.
Yeah.
No matter who the oppressor is, he will deliver you from them.
Yeah.
Are you getting me, sir? Do you know, sir, there are some evil dreams. They come your way. If you don't do anything about it, it will happen exact way you see it. The way you had that accident in your dream, that is the same way your car will crash. Do you know, sir, many of these accidents in the street are manipulated from the realm of the spirit? Some of us think it's a carelessness. It's not always the case all the time. That is a demonic manipulation. Number three, who are they? They are men or women that their marital life is barren. Marital barrenness. When every other person has said, I love you, darling, I love you, sweetie, they never hear such voice in their life. What they saw in their marriage, they never bargained for it. They never knew that a man could slap them. They never knew that a man could abandon them with their children. They never see it in their life when it came. Some didn't know that they are going to divorce. They never believed that they can experience divorce in life until it came. And they know they wake up in the night, no man around them. They know they cry. Sometimes the children will come and say, Mommy, you are crying again. Mommy, you are crying again. It's a bandage. And the Lord will deliver you.
Amen.
I'm sent here to look for such people. Who are they? Those who are stagnant in life. They call it stagnation of life. Their life is not going forward. And their life is not going backward. They are experiencing a merry-go-round life. They call it Kadesh Barnea. Their life is within a circumference. They are walking through a circle. Look at the drama we watched that time. When those ladies came back to meet the man, they are still in the same circle. They walk over time, but their life is still in the same circle. That's bondage. Men are waiting for you all over the world because they believe you are the Joseph of the family. But you are in a terrible chain here. Who are they finally? They are men and women that carry sickness that cannot be cured. We diagnose them for different cases and there is no solution to it. Sickness and disease is a demonic. It's a chain. And the Lord said to me, it will turn your captivity around.
Amen.
How, what is it that can turn your captivity? Is only one thing, hot prayers. God via hot prayers. In the book of James chapter 5 verse 13, is anyone afflicted? Bible says, let him pray. Prayer is the antidote to oppressions. When a man prays, a man loses the key of the devil against his life. Are you there? Every form of oppressions will depart from you.
Is any
among you afflicted? Let him pray. If there is any affliction, prayer is the key to it. Prayer dissolved every chain of the devil. That was why the people of Israel were in Egypt for 430 years and they suffered. But in the book of Exodus chapter 2 for verse 23, they said they cried unto the Lord in their bounty and their cry went to God. Until they cried, they are still in the same place. When you open your mouth to say no, heaven will also say no. He will deliver you this morning.
Amen.
In the book of Isaiah chapter 49, I saw something there that I want to share with you because it is time for your deliverance. Isaiah 49 verses 24 to 26. Surely the prey be taken from the mighty, or the lawful captive delivered. But thus saith the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken away, and the prey of the terrible shall be delivered. For I will contend with him that contended with thee, and I will save thy children. Verse 26, and I will feed them that oppress thee with their own flesh, and they shall be drunken with their own blood, as with sweet wine. And all the flesh shall know that I, the Lord, I am thy Savior and thy Redeemer, the mighty one of Jacob.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Yes,
he will do it.
Amen.
He will deliver you from the captives.
Amen.
Every authority that rises against you, he will destroy them.
Amen.
You are not here by chance. You are here for something. You are here to be delivered.
Amen.
I don't know which cage, which prison the enemy has put you. There is what we call physical prison. There's what we call spiritual prison. Physical prison is better than spiritual prison. Are you with me? For a man to be locked up in the physical prison and be taken to prison is better. But for a man to be walking around physically, but is in prison spiritually, is the greatest prison that no man should experience. Are you getting me, sir? They see you, you go out. When you are in the physical prison here, they will feed you. They give you bed. They give you television. You eat what you like. But when you are in the spiritual bondage, people are now waiting for you to help them, and they don't know that you are in jail yourself. It's a terrible thing. Sometimes some big men will go to bedroom, to their restroom, and cry, "What is happening to me? What am I doing here? Why this mess? There's a chain somewhere. God will deliver you from that chain."
Amen.
Are you ready to pray that prayer?
Yes,
let me ask you to pray one or two prayers. And I would ask you not to stop here. Get to a place and pray. Is there any place where we can pray and pray? You wait. You don't have it. Get out of your business sometimes and pray. Get holiday. Take a leave. Take a break and seek God. If you have done everything possible and you are not getting results, get up and pray. Nobody should put you into marital barrenness. There is no reason why you should not have children. There is no reason why you should be sleeping with that woman and the baby refuse to come. There is no reason why the man should come to you regularly and you don't have anything to show for. That was the system of Hannah. Hannah rose up. No! I am not going to take this any longer. Why will you walk here? And then at the end of the month, you are still in debt. Rise to your feet. You hear me well? Anything that is not good must be, you must reject. It's not your portion. Are you with me? When you cry, God respond. When you keep quiet, God sit down. You did hear me, sir? God is only being moved by what comes out of you. Your voice and God are connected. Anytime you speak out, when you put your child on the bed and the child remains silent, you leave him. But what? Even if you don't attend to him, the neighbor will call the police. This boy is saying something, and we must understand it. We must know what he's saying. So anytime you are quiet, God is quiet. Anytime you rise up and cry, heaven will respond. Are you ready?
Yes.
You will shout. Only two prayer points. Then you see that because there are three sets of people I want to minister to. And these are the first one. We are talking about the second one quickly. Oh God, enough is enough. You ask God to break the yoke. You will cry down,
oh God.
Every chain of captivity,
every chain of captivity
in my life. Amen.
Amen.
Can you break it?
Yes.
When you want to say break, say break.
He's
not talking of how many years you've been there. 430 years. History, they were in bondage. But the day they cried, God came up. Every form, every chain of captivity against my marriage, against my finance, break. Against my health, break. You can't die now. You are called to live in peace. You cannot be carrying sickness. Sickness is not your portion. Every chain of captivity in my finance, break. Chain of captivity in my marriage, break. I am the Zion God is referring to. Can you open your mouth and pray? Open your mouth and pray in the name of Jesus. You are not praying. You are not talking to God. Talk to the Lord. Chain of captivity. Chain of captivity. Chain of captivity in my life. Chain of captivity in my marriage. Chain of captivity in my home. Chain of captivity. in my assignment. Break now. In Jesus' mighty name, pray. In Jesus' mighty name, pray. Do you know, sir, there is only one language that the deaf understand. He doesn't understand two. So if you have that one, Satan run away. If you don't have it, he stay with you. And the language is the language of violence. Anytime you want to address the devil, don't speak gently. He doesn't want it. That's why when Jesus wants to bring down Lazarus, say, Lazarus! He didn't say Lazarus. He won't come. Because those who held Lazarus down, they held him fast. Are you with me?
Yes.
You are going to cry out, I command you to lose your hold. Break! Somebody say, break!
Break!
It's not talking about age. It's not talking about size. Something must arise from here. That is anger. You must hate your situation. Hear me, sir. The best among us, you have not really attained 1/100 of God's plan for you. The best here. I don't know whether you get what I'm saying. The best among us, we have never attained 1/100 of what God has in store. I want you to shout, break! And when you want to say, break! You financial bandage! You terrible sickness! Bless upon my life! Break! You marital disorderness! I command you, break! You terrible nightmares! I set you ablaze! Break! If you can say break, it gets out. Are you ready?
Yes.
When you want to call the name of Jesus, say the name of Jesus. When you call him, I say every. You may not close your eyes. That sometimes you address the devil, you don't close your eyes. You look at him eyeball for eyeball. Enough is enough. Every of your chain upon my children, break. Your chain upon my ministry, break. Your chain upon my body, upon my physical body, break. Your chain upon my marriage, break. Open your mouth and pray in the name of Jesus. Oh, yeah. Are you sure? Are you opening your mouth to pray? I can see one man pray. I see one man pray. I see another woman pray. Chain upon me. Chain upon me. I command you to pray. I command you to pray. Pray in the name of Jesus. Pray in the name of Jesus. Every chain of the devil over my life, over my life, over my home, over my children. I command you, break by fire. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Listen, I look at me. I love the way you are praying. It shows fire is on the mountain. Look up here. I became a pastor, and I was pastoring church, and I wore 2 shirts and 1 trousers for 5 years. Baba, I wore 2 shirts, 2 and 1 trousers and 1 shoe for 5 years. We were sleeping on a bare floor. We can't buy mattress. My new wife, she had a wrapper. We used that wrapper as a bed. We had our first child 9 months, 18 days after our wedding. The boy saw poverty. He went back to heaven. We could have had 5 boys. The first one couldn't stand the poverty. When we get back to him, the doctor said I should go and buy baby food because my wife's milk doesn't come from her breast. I went, I didn't return. Poverty. If you come to my room and you want to sit down, you sit down quickly, you jump up quickly. Because there is a nail there. So I have to teach you how to sit down. I have the television. When you put it on, you can travel, want to travel, because the next 1 hour is still boosting. It's coming. That's why I will never allow this girl to suffer.
Amen. She suffered with me. One day, one man met me on the street. Said, "Stop there, pastor." I told him, "Said, I want to talk to you today. Whether you will take it or not, I don't care." He spoke Yoruba. I didn't eat it back yet. But the anointing was upon me, plus the suffering. I didn't know that there was a chain somewhere. One day, I rose up. I said, "God, what did God say? Pay the price." Every greatness has a price. If you can't pay it, you can't attain it. I said, "God, what's the price?" I said, "If you can stand on the mountain." And I went back to my wife. I said, "I am leaving this house, and I am coming back the next 1 year. You won't see me coming home. I am going on the mountain to sort out this evil." Ask my wife. 1st of January, I was driven to the mountain. And I was there for 365 days. I didn't come down in a minute. You demonic power that is oppressing my life, I am came here for a purpose. Oh God, lose your grip. And I came down after 365 days to have a story that changed. My story changed. My story changed. Sir, if there is anyone, it may not be all of you. That's why you don't have to join others in this prayer. Others may be keeping quiet. They may not be the person. But you may be the one. Open your mouth and cry. I cried out. I cried out to God. One, after I spent 3 months, my wife came to visit me. She came to visit me, and when she was going, as she was coming down from where I was praying, I just heard that. I said, "What happened?" She said, "God, 3 months." I said, "Don't keep faith. I have decided that our story must change. When you see any man called great, he has paid the price." Yes. Are you getting me, sir? Yes. That's why I told you the other time. You don't least watch the glory of a man listening to his story. Because behind every glory, there is a story. Nobody is suddenly great. It's not an accident. The price has been paid. Are you ready?
Yes.
Break the yoke now. Are you ready?
Yes.
I want you to begin to jump up and say, "Lose your grip. You demonic power that is holding my marriage." If it is your marriage they are holding, if they are holding your academics, or they are holding your finance, they are holding your health, I command you in the name of Jesus, lose your grip. Open your mouth and begin to pray. Declare me by force. Every authority that is working against my life, I command you to lose your grip. I fire you out of my life. Get out in the name of Jesus. Get out in the name of Jesus. Get out in the name of Jesus. On the other side, yes, sir. Holy God, I command you in the name of Jesus. Break your yoke. Open your mouth wide. Shout. Shout. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. All eyes closed. You are being oppressed in one area of the other. And I want to pray for you. Wherever you are, you feel there is an oppression somewhere. And you want to come out. Lift up your right hand where you are. I want to minister to you, and I want you to write down this date that is over today.
Amen.
I sprinkle the blood of Jesus into these hands for deliverance.
Amen.
Yes, Lord. Lisatalia. Imandu sekataligaba. Pulin e eligata azuzukaya. I command the flow of the blood of Jesus into these hands. Blood of Jesus, cover this hand. That hand upon your head. I break that yoke.
Amen.
Yes. I command that evil bad luck be loose.
Amen.
That chain, that demonic chain against Zion is destroyed today.
Amen.
Be free.
Amen.
If your amen is loud, then be free.
Amen.
As from today,
your story will change.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Be seated and hear the second set of people that God sent me to. Psalm 126, verse 5. Psalm 126, verse 5. Are you there? Not there. Psalm 126, verse 5. The man has gone out to the restroom. They that sow in tears shall what? Shall reap in joy. These are the second set of people the Lord sent me to in this special day of the woman. Who are they? We call them the sowers in tears. Despite all hopes, they refuse to give up. They stay focused. They were sure of their Redeemer. Therefore, you know what they do? They guide their destiny jealously. Are you with me? Though everything looked like it's tough, everything looked like it's not going to work, but they are not distracted. They were focused. The woman's convention is talking about being focused. They didn't allow it to form of distraction. They stay glued to where they are going. In their hand, they carry their destiny. They know that they are here for a purpose. Everything might be changing, but God can't change. The situation may look terrible. Things may look hard. Marriage, my God, they might have lost their marriage. Their children may be wayward. Their finance may be down. But they held on to their God. They call them sowers in tears. They that sows, if they sow in tears, shall reap in joy. Everything is going against them, but they know that their Redeemer is strong. Read it, Job chapter 14. Job was talking to us about something in Job chapter 14, verses 7 to 9. I want to speak with you so that you can understand it. For there is hope of a tree, if it be cut down, that it will sprout again, and that the tender branch therefore will not cease. The next verse, though the root thereof was old in the head, and the stalk thereof died in the ground, yet through the scent of water it will bud, and bring forth boughs like a plant. You are coming back.
Amen.
Are you with me, sir?
Yes.
Did you know, sir, the world can call you a failure, but do you tell me, sir, you can never fail? Man can never fail. There is no scripture that shows that man can fail. The teachers in school can fail you. That is human idea. It's only human opinion where you can see failure. In God's agenda, there is no man that is permitted to fail. Man can fall, but he can't fail. That's why the enemy should not rejoice when I fall. Even if I fall, I will bounce back again. I don't know whether you are the one. You might have made an error. Your marriage could be in a mess. It doesn't matter. Your husband could back out and leave you with children. That's not the end of the road. It may be as if they tell you that you are going back home, that you are not qualified to live here. They are not the owner of this place. I don't know if you are the one I'm ministering to. Oh no! Something might look at you are over age. Your mates are married and they are having children. That is not your concern. When you keep having children, you will overtake them.
Yes.
I don't know whether you are with me.
Yes,
one woman was barren for 16 years in Nigeria. And at the 16th year, she got pregnant and had 4 boys in at a go. She overtook all of them. Are you with me? She got pregnant 2 years later, and the doctor said, "What a big tummy." They went for scan. Scan showed another 4 boys. Tell your neighbor, you may be seeing me today, but this is not me. Me is still coming. Don't underrate the man sitting there. He may look like you are not getting it, but that's not the end. Like I told you now, that man is not permitted to fail. It's not in God's agenda. You've been to prison. It's not the end of your journey. You can bounce back from the prison and make it in life.
Do you know what can kill you? Yourself. The only person that can stop you is you. No man is permitted to stop you. You are unstoppable. Listen to me. That you have done a business to business back to Africa and it got ruined, it's not the end. That you are in debt and you are paying back the debt, don't cry. When you can get to the scent of water, you will board up again. Are you getting me? And what is the scent of water? The power of God. Power of God is available to bring you back. Hello, somebody? Are you there?
Yes.
Mary said to Jesus, you came late. If you had come early, my brother could have been saved. But you came late. Yes, sir, but I'm here already. He said, yes, but you are late. My brother will rise again in the day of judgment. In the last, he said, no, I am the resurrection and life. Can you believe that 4 days old in the grave can come back? The sister said, if we open this stone now, there will be terrible odor here. Because it must be stinking by now. When God arrives, all your stinkiness will go.
Amen.
Are you with me, sir?
Yes.
Oh, 39 years old, you are not married. On your wedding day, they will come and see. You are still going to wear your wedding gown.
Amen.
If you are the one, let your amen sound clear. And
amen.
Nobody should look down you. Oh, you are married 12 years, no issue. Don't bother. You are about to give birth to another Samuel who is going to rule over the world.
Yeah.
That is what God is preparing you for. Yeah. So you know what they did? Because they know this, so they stay focused. They were not distracted. They keep serving their Lord. They keep jubilating. They keep believing that God will do it. They were sure that their Redeemer is alive. My sister, the problem that comes upon you now is for today. Your tomorrow is sure.
Yeah.
Are you sure what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
God sent me to those second set of people to hear it. Everybody that comes around now, they are mocking you. Your mockers will still attend your celebration.
Yeah.
In fact, they are the one who's going to set the cheers on that day.
Yeah.
You believe it?
Yes, sir.
When I came into ministry, I told you I got born again, and my name Abdul Latif, I got born again. And all my six children of my mother gave their life to Christ, and we all became a pastor. All of us. We had only one girl, that last born, Marie Genovese. All of us are not into part-time, full-time ministry. They mocked my mother. They called my mother and said, look at you. Your children has gone into ministry. You will suffer. There's no way. They have to wait for come. Everybody will bring before they can take it. You are finished. My mother came and she was crying. I said, what are you crying for? The King of Kings has employed us. We are employed by the man who owns the universe. Richard and the gate called me into service. But she looked at me that day, two shirts and one trust. A man with two shirts and one trust is boasting. I was so sure that tomorrow is bright. Are you with me? My mother is 83 now, see jump. When I did her 80th birthday, the whole nation stood.
Hallelujah.
And my mother said, Apostle, I said, I won't die now. I said, I know you won't die now. You can't see glory at that. Do you know that some of us today, we have been a written person before? Some of us got here by, we don't even believe. God who brought you here will finish the work.
Yeah.
Just be shaking here and tell your neighbor, a great man is sitting around you here. There's somebody around you. Let them see you now. There are great persons around here. Mama, I am called to tell you that you are not old. You are not too old to enjoy life.
Amen.
You know why? At the age when Abraham was how many years old? When he was 70. When Abraham was 99, God came back to him and said, Abraham, I am your God. When Abraham was 138, he married another wife. And the woman gave birth to 6 children. You don't read your Bible very well. Abraham was still bouncing. And I read in Genesis 24, verse 1. Bible says, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. Not your today, your tomorrow. You have a great tomorrow. Tell your neighbor, I have a great tomorrow. So don't look down me. Don't
in tears. It was terrible. They supposed not to sow, but they guided their destiny with all jealousy, and they know that they have to build a better tomorrow. Don't give up. Tell your neighbor, don't give up. Yes, your day, your tomorrow is bright. You have a better tomorrow. Are you with me? You have a better tomorrow. I lost everything they could take off of a child. I didn't get any. My father and I never talked good until he died. My father and I never sit down to discuss for 1 minute. We are like enemy. In fact, one day I asked my mother, are you sure this man will get back? This man was my father. I lost everything. I went to school, no education, nothing, zero. My father had 16 wives, so my mother left when I was 6 years old. And my father said, this one won't go with you, he's old enough. So he drew me back, and that was how I became a robber. And then by age nine, I became terrible. The anointing for stealing came upon me. The way I steal, when I got born again, I checked it. I knew that this is an anointing operation. Because I saw myself not breaking into any hole, I open door. There is no door that I can open. The moment I see the law, the anointing will come and will teach me how to open. Are you with me? Mama, all my senior sisters who are there that are working, you know, anytime they want to sleep, all of them will carry their bag and they will lock up them. This is where Latisse in the house. I can't be in the house and you sleep with your two wives. You have to close one and open another. This is the way all my sisters sleep this way. Because Lati, which is a night. Everybody will lock up this way. 1 a.m. anointing will come. And I will wake up. I will open their door. Go inside. Remove their leg. Take away the bag. Remove their money. The worst of it is I will return the bag to where the entrance. It's only money. Before they wake up, Latia has gone. They wake up. You don't need to ask who steal my money. You just begin to cry, Lati, Lati. They won't see me until I finish them. I was taken to prison, and I told my other guy, "Say I will get home." He said, "From where?" I said, "We are locked up already." I said, "He feel in market go lekoko tabi irawe tadoli osu." I was so bold, very small in stature, but devilish in heart. I escaped from prison. It was in the record of that prison that one prisoner escaped from here. Terrible. I didn't go to school. If I enter school 8 a.m., I must close by 8:30. The maximum time we spend in the compound of any school is 30 minutes. We must get out to go and smoke. I look terrible. When I knocked the door of my mother will open the door and say, yes. I said, I want to enter. I said, say it there. Because it's there, not inside. My mother took me to all known abadis. See my face? Incisions. They were putting blade. See blade. They marked my face. They were just marking it. Anyhow. Are you with me? But this is what I saw. Anytime I'm going with my mother to the same abadis, awful and awful. I will see the abadi say, Mama, go to your son very well. Go to your son. But this also will go to his bedroom and keep his money. Because they are nothing I carry. Abadi's home can't handle it. He will also cry. Are you with me? When God called me to ministry, he sent me to Ifo. And Ifo, where I was sent, is known for one thing worldwide. Omoli Ifo. That's only what we are known for. I met armed robbers. I met them in that cave where God sent me. I shared with them my testimony and they came out. I have some of them who are former armed robbers here, who are now zonal pastors in my church. The king of our place is our admin director. I told them, if God can change my life, if God can make me to become the joy of my father, when I was finishing my exam, I knew my result before it was pasted.
So not a surprise. I had F9 parallel. Yoruba, even my dog, they gave me F9. Oh, you know F9? You know Fatai 9, 9, 9. We are writing English the money. I went to party. You know, my fan there was Wasiwaide. You know Wasiwaide? You don't know him. Hey, be kuri. Let me tell us so much. I drank all night, and we are writing English 9 a.m. tomorrow. I got home 6 a.m. I said, Nati, sit down like this so that you won't sleep. As I sat down, I woke up 9:30, and I quickly wear my shirt. I ran to the exam hall. When I got there, the vigilator was mad. He said, stupid boy, get out now. He added another 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, come in, stupid boy, come in! And he gave me my paper. Everybody has been there for over 1 hour writing. I got there, we started with objective, English objective. Objective is easy. If it's not here, it must be B. I didn't read question, I was only feeling answer. That was I ended in 5 minutes. They gave me compression paper, I looked at it, I said, he said, why did I know that Yaya is a man from the north? I said, I asked them again, why did you know that Yaya is from the north? The question they asked me, I asked them. And I was the first person to finish it. When I finished, I submitted it. The man didn't call me again. He shook his head. I had other stories. More paper. I said, what did I write? What did I write? Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
But I came to know one thing, that's not the end. The situation you are going through today is not the end. Yeah. The marital disorderness, trouble in your family today is not the end. The light of tomorrow will bring a new day. Yeah. That's the person God sent me to. Today I became the joy of my mother, and I thank that my mother didn't die. About 3-4 years ago, I brought her to U.S. She stays here in Houston for 6 months. She came back to Nigeria. When she came back to Nigeria, we went to collect it. Later, we didn't recognize her again. She looked very, my mother put on a very nice gown. Everybody who went to collect her didn't know. They just passed by. Ah, mama, he said, I would die now. She's 93. You have a brighter tomorrow. Tell your neighbor, don't underrate me. Something great is around you. But with all this, your past, how do you come about it? That's what I'm saying. We are talking about God who can bring nothing, who can bring something from nothing. God who can make zero hero. We are talking about God. You cannot determine it when it comes to action. Anything that is God in your life, He has the power to bring them back. You will have children. Are you with me? Nobody knew with all this background I could become one of the best husbands ever produced in the world. I asked my wife, she would tell me. Nobody knew. Nobody knew that I could become a preacher of the gospel. Nobody knew that I could travel around the world and deliver the heart of God. I was in Atlanta in October 1st last year to come and hold the national anniversary of Nigeria here. All the churches in Atlanta gathered together, and I was invited as a guest speaker. One day I was called upon that I need to go and pray with the governor of Georgia in his office, the Capitol Hall. And I was there. 5 men of God around the nation were invited, my wife and I, one of them. So when we got there, we were introducing them. I'm a pastor, I'm a pastor, I'm a pastor. My wife said, we are finished. I said, we can't be finished. We glory, you can't be finished. When you carry glory, you can't be finished. Yes. It is well with you.
Amen.
And when it came to my town, they said, we now invite the post to Dimbola. He's going to pray for Georgia. Okay. I said, I came from a Muslim family. My mother left me. They just said, hey. Everybody sat down where to hear me. They will hear you.
Amen.
They may write you off like Joseph, but God is writing you here as a prime minister.
Amen.
They wrote him in as a slave, but God write him in as a prime minister. That's God. If you are the one I'm talking to, can you jump up on your feet and begin to say, yes, that one is for me. I will stay focused. I will not lose my focus. I will not lose God. I will not go back.
I will not be tired walking with him. Begin to confess your future. Tell the Lord, my tomorrow is bright. Don't kill yourself. Enjoy your flight. Enjoy your flight. Le satali kabolande, le posoto koyande kabala. Thank you, Father God. Robo sete kete telia. I see the hand of the Lord upon your life. You will enjoy life. You will not suffer. I will not suffer. I will not suffer. My marriage will work. My marriage will work. I will have children. I will not be barren. I cannot die young. I cannot die in sickness. Sickness is not my portion. I am waiting for the new day. A new dawn of a new day. A new ministry. A new life. Yes, Satakaria Baba Baba. Satakaria Baba. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Listen to me and look up here. I was in Pastor Roland's house with my wife, and every morning I liked his tea. He liked giving us tea. And I also liked drinking tea with big cup. Yeah, man, sir. As they brought the tea, we put the Lipton tea inside the cup. Hot water. And as we put it in there, I saw the color of the water change. And the Lord said, look at that. I said, see, do you see that the hot water is helping that lifting to fulfill his desire, his destiny? He said, when I want to bring out glory from a man, I will allow him to pass through hot life. And I look at my wife. My wife didn't know what I had from heaven. And I got to know from that moment that when any man is passing through a tough time, he's a lifting tea. Yeah. But if the lifting tea bag said no to hot water, we won't see his glory. Yes. Am I talking to you, mama?
Yes, sir.
That thing you are going through is a normal thing. For you to get to where you are going,
amen.
You will reach there.
Amen.
And you said the two hands up and say, I will reach there.
I will reach there.
You will reach your destiny.
Amen.
You will reach your goal.
Amen.
I will be fulfilled in life.
Amen.
I am a tea bag
inside hot water.
I will release glory. Men will celebrate my glory. So shall it be. Your hand together for the Lord Jesus. Let me sit down. Let me spend the next 5 minutes to wrap it up so that you can be blessed fully. Those are the third person. The third kind of people the Lord sent me to are found in the last verse of that chapter 126, verse 6, Psalm 126, verse 6. That's the last people that I got here, and I want to wrap it up so that you can understand it. Where is the scripture? It's not on the screen. Psalm 126. Let's read it together, but that's where we stop now. 1, 2, go. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall darkness come again with rejoicing, bringing a sheaf with him. These are the third person. We call them the bearers of precious seed. The bearer, say it, bearers of precious seed. Who are they? They knew that the situation looked tough, but they counted all joy. They acted like an overcomer. In those terrible situations, they carry their seed, precious seed, and put it in God's hand. They are so sure that it cannot fail. In the time of terrible famine, Isaac performed it in Genesis 26, verse 1. Bible told us there was a famine, another famine, not the one in the day of Abraham. Isaac saw the famine. It was terrible. Decision was tough. But in verse 12 of Genesis 26, Isaac sowed his precious seed in the time of famine because he was so sure that God cannot fail. And you know what he did? He received it back that same year. You know, grateful. Hallelujah. I was 53 years ago. I celebrated my golden jubilee. I was 50. And I said, God, you have kept me for 50 years. Useless boy. I got born again when I was 23 years old.
old, I got born again. This year marked my 38th year that I gave my life to Jesus. Amen. My 38th year that I gave my life to Him. And I've never gone back a day. I look at what God has done for me. Some 3-4 years before my 58th year, God, I must sow a seed. And I call my wife. My wife shook my decision. God has shaken. I said, you and I, we are going to build a 5,000 seat auditorium for God. A church that can seat 5,000 people alone. We shall build it and make it a sacrifice, a seed for God to celebrate my 58th year. And we got the land and we laid the foundation, began to build. 5,000 seat auditorium alone. Ha! After some years, it got very close. I called my wife, if I can't build it, may I not see my 58th year? But sometimes when you have your precious seed, your appetite will be calling you to eat it. That's the problem with men in church, why they cannot pay their tithe. And somebody was calling me now that the tithe became an issue. What do I say? It can't be. The problem of money is only given to men who has made money their God. Some people has made money their God, and we are now giving it out as offering. It brings sadness into your heart. There are some people, dollar is their God. And you now pick it up and say, God, take. They say, are you crazy? It's our God you are throwing away. So they are the one who give you problem about what you give a tithe. Four or five years ago, I told my wife, I'm changing my tithe level. She said to what? I said, I'll begin to give God 20%. I've been giving God 20% of my income since 5 years ago. That you are a pastor doesn't stop you from giving tithe. You pay tithe. Because I know what the Bible says about it. When you carry your precious seed in your hand, your appetite, is it your esophagus? Your throat is it. Eat it! Because to sow it, there's a risk. Something will tell you, supposing it doesn't comfort. Are you crazy? Eat it! But Isaac carried his own precious seed in the time of famine, and he planted it. Others were mocking him. Crazy boy, you are dense. No rain, no sign of cloud, and you are sowing. He said, I know that God will bless me. Are you with me? They carry a seed in their hand, and they sow the seed. And then, when they return, they sow precious seed. They came back with sheep. If you have seen corn before, when you plant a corn, at the end of the 3 months, when you come back, you start drawing down corn. And in one of the sheaves, you can have over 500 corns. And you sowed only one seed. That is not just a seed, but a precious seed. Not just ordinary seed. Something that matters to them. That was why Anna won the heart of God. She gave to God her precious seed. She gave it to God as a loan. He said, God, I have given this child to you as a loan. And God returned to him another 6, making 7 children. When you want to increase your life, one of the best ways to increase your life is to look for a precious seed and give it to God. And say, God, I know that as far as you live it, I cannot fail. Amen. And when you put it in the hand of God, you can go to rest. God looked down from heaven and we began to build. One day my wife woke up around 3 a.m. and woke up and she began to cry. I said, what happened? He said, you are going to destroy yourself. I said, what do you mean? Where will you get money to finish this house? Because my wife knew we have only less than 1 year more and we still need millions of money. The governor of our state came to open the place. When the governor came, he said, wow! He said, before, I said, it can happen anywhere. Great edifice can be raised anywhere in the world. Why is he? The governor couldn't believe it. I said, listen, my wife, this house where we are sleeping now, who owns it? He said, we are the one. Why are you crying? There's no money again. We sell this house. And we back to church.
start living church and use it to finish the house.
She said, to.
I said, yes, to. Go to. We still have something we can sell. And by the grace of God, God is merciful. We finished the house of God. And the same day, we dedicated our new six-bedroom duplex. The same day.
Hallelujah.
God will ever be faithful. Say, faithful God. My son, second son, got admission to university. And he came, Daddy, I'm going to say, you better sit down. I'll use your school fees to be out. You are part of the sacrifice. He said, I said, go and sit down. You are going next year. And she said, and he said, no. Do you know what God did? After the dedication of the house of God, I told my wife, I will take my son to UK just to compensate him. Then I took his visa here, and for the first time, United Kingdom gave my son 2 years multiple visa. And we paid for 6 months. You know that I took him to UK, he came back. January this following year, the school has resumed over 4 months. January the following year, Bowen University, the school that got him admitted, had problem with all the students. They saw they sent all the students home, and the school authority decided to do another admission. And my son was admitted to start his own level. He's now in 300 level. Computer science. You know what? When you give your precious seed to God, from your depth of your heart, enjoy. God will look down from heaven, and God will turn it around. Mama, please come. Come and join me, Mama. Mama, please come up on the altar. A woman will decorate this place. Is that what you said? Brother? We want the woman also to plant a terrible seed for the house of God, new house of God that we are moving into. This place is too small for us. Can we tell our Father in the Lord that this place is too small for us? That did we hear that this place is too small? We have outgrown this place. This place is outdated. Where are we going to? Our own property. Is it possible?
Yes, sir.
With our precious seed, women will now go to Daddy and say, Daddy, we are laying down this. This is what we have put together. We want to move from here. And we want to see what God will do. You will now see to come to time. Anybody who come to this church with 2015 vehicle will be called a poor person. For you. No, you say you are poor. 2017, we only manage you. It's 2018. They say somebody says it's possible. They say, go to Grace Assembly. Go and see them. If they don't, we don't know the way they are doing it over there. But all of them are rich. You will be one of them. Not down payment, you pay up. See how much is it? Say 65,000. Let me bring it out. He said, are you going to pay small, small? I said, which small, small? I said, bring it out. And we are buying two, one for me, one for my wife. Are you getting me, sir? All the houses where you are living now, you will soon move out to another place. We will have our estate. So they will not put a signboard at Grace. Go and write it down. By the quality of the seed you are sowing today, by the strength of the seed you are sowing now, things will change.
Amen.
Mommy, please give me the oil. I want to anoint them. And if it doesn't happen, that means God didn't send me. I have done it, it worked for me. In one day, we gave out 5,000 seat auditorium to God. Finished. Not partially finished, fully finished. Everything you can think of is there. Do you know, sir, our pastor, Pastor Badu, came to Nigeria. You can ask him when you see, even know anybody behind that in this. The pastor heard me about me, and he said, now if the man is great, he can't be in Ifo, he should be in Lagos. And he came to Nigeria and he saw for me. We have never seen before. That's why we ever live to respect him. He said, I've come to see what I was told about you. And I drove him to the campground to see. I now know, let me be going. And he took a check and he wrote a check and gave him. That great man of God is in Houston. He's in Redeemed Church. People will come and see.
Amen.
When we finish the edifice of this church,
people will come and see.
Amen.
You alone will cause a change.
Amen.
And I will anoint you for a great exploit.
Amen.
And things will turn around. If you are one of us, I'm not talking of seed of $10, I'm not talking of seed, I'm talking of seed of $500, $1,000. I'm talking of seed of $250. I'm talking of seed of $5,000. Just give it to me. And we are talking about building a house for the Lord because we are great. I told you on Friday, if you can remember, I said all of you are pastors in this church. I told them all of you are assistant pastors, assistant pastors, assistant pastors, assistant pastors. Pastor in charge of a house. Pastor in charge of menu men, pastor in charge of a rush, pastor in charge of a Sunday school, pastor in charge of, you are all, whether you like it or not, you are a pastor. Why do you need to be a pastor? So that we are going to stand up and sit on the altar while the new members will rush in and join us. Rise to your feet. I want to anoint you. Daddy, thank you, sir. I want to put this oil upon your life and I want to put upon your destiny as I close this service. Go send me. Mama, please come. Amen. Just few of them. You can just tell Mama to celebrate Mother's Day and to round off your anniversary. We want to sow a seed that can be laid down for the building of our great edifice. Where we will call our home, not rented apartment. We build the church on 1 acre of land, the church alone, and we got a land of 15 acres. We want to be part. We want to bring our precious seed, and we want to see our God in action. And the hand of the Lord will come. We raise it up. Father, together with your servant, Daddy, please come. Mama, come. We raise this oil. That is the life of man. As many that you touch them and they see a need for this seed, cause a change in their lives.
Amen.
As this oil come upon them, let it become the oil of lifting.
Amen.
Lifting that has never been seen before in America.
Amen.
As a kind of great explosion.
Amen.
Financial explosion.
Amen.
That nobody has ever recorded before in America.
Amen.
Let it come upon these people in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
It shall be well with you. In Jesus' mighty name. Usher, please get me 20 great envelopes for them. This is not our Sunday offering. It's just a seed for this service. If you want one of us who want to be part of this seed, come forward. Let me anoint you. And I call my God to come into operation. As you come, you take that envelope from that man, that woman of God, and I will anoint you. And I pray that the Lord will arise and do something great in your life.
Amen.
And then you will know that this God is God. Come and take it. Make it great. You can send it to the account of the church. You can. I'm not saying that you should give me. I'm talking about we want to live here. We want to start planning how to move from here to our new place.